we know how to use quantum mechanics, but the basic meaning of quantum mechanics is not understood at all. I would subscribe to that. And I know my friend Feynman believed that he knew how to use quantum mechanics, but he didn't understand. In fact, what he said was, quantum mechanics is so confusing that I can't even tell if there's a problem about the foundations of quantum mechanics. Certainly, Einstein, of course, had problems with quantum mechanics. And pretty much everybody I know will tell you that that the foundations of quantum mechanics, ultimate meaning, is really not understood. There's all these crazy theories, like many worlds theories and other things that don't make a lot of sense to me, but are very, very confusing. And I really think we don't understand quantum mechanics at the deepest level. Okay, what's the problem? I think the problem is that when we think about a quantum mechanical experiment, we separate the world into the system that we're studying, which might be all of the rest of the world, and the apparatus or the observer. We separate them, and we don't think of the apparatus and observer as part of the system. We think of it as something which can interact with the system, but not as part of the system. We separate the world in that way. And that's essential for the way we use quantum mechanics. It's essential to make that separation. On the other hand, the detectors, the observers, really are part of the system. We need to be able to describe in a single way both the system we're operating on, that we're studying, and the observers and the detectors. And furthermore, there can be multiple observers. Maybe there are even branches of the wave functions where there are no observers. So I think it's a separation into observers and system, which is artificial. It's not really part of the world. The real world is everything is described by one set of principles and equations. The observers, the detectors are all, and the system we're studying, all part of the same system. And when we use quantum mechanics, we almost invariably make a separation into two distinct things. That's why we have this problem about collapse of the wave function. It's not collapse of the wave function. It's our detectors becoming entangled with the system we're studying. And I don't think we understand that yet. I don't feel I understand.
Yeah. Well, the many worlds people, you don't understand them or you don't think they're on the right track?
I have questions about it, which they can never answer. It's a technical questions. There may be some truth to it. I don't know. I don't understand it. No.
What are the technical questions that you put up to the many worlds proponents that they are unable to respond to?
Well, first of all, there's this picture of branching pieces of the wave function, which branch and branch and branch, and you know the way a tree grows. If you go upward from the trunk, the trees grow, but the branches never come back together again. Okay, that's the picture of the branching universe according to the many worlds idea. The universe is branches and branches, but it's about probability tree. It's a decision tree. Mm-hmm. It keeps growing, growing. Well, that's not correct. There's no question that the principles of quantum mechanics do allow the branches to grow back together again. And so that's one factor that they're using the wrong mathematics to describe this branching tree of possibilities. And the other is a technical problem.
The measure problem?
Yeah, there's a measure problem, but the question is, how many branches emerge from each decision? From each decision, how many branches emerge? You usually think two decisions. It was this thing or the other thing. But that's not correct. If the probabilities for two things to happen are half and a half, then you can imagine the universe splits into two parts. What if they're a quarter and three quarters? Do you require mm-hmm. the universe splits into four parts, one of which does one thing, three of which do the other thing? What if it's some irrational number, the relative probabilities? Then the universe at each node has to split into an infinite number of parts in order to accommodate irrational numbers. So there are technical problems, and I don't dismiss the idea. I just say I don't think it's understood. My friend Atuft dismisses the idea completely, and he may be right. I don't know.
Tuft is someone who you respect greatly and you think is an original thinker. And he has his deterministic, super deterministic quantum mechanics.
Right.
What is your opinion on that?
I understand where he's coming from. I understand the question he's trying to address. I don't think I can dismiss what he says. It's very super deterministic view of things. Most of the people I know dismiss it. They think he's gone a little crazy. I don't. But I still think it's wrong.
For reasons.
But, you know, I don't know what's right. So what use is there in saying I think he's wrong if I don't tell you at the same time what I think? That's like the string theorists. I'm not the string theorists. The critics of string theory who say bad, 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 bad. It's not probable, but they don't give you any positive idea of what might be right. Here, in criticizing both the many worlds and Tuft, which is the opposite extreme, I don't have anything to offer which is any better. So which line of thinking, which of these two almost diametrically opposed lines of thinking may lead to some new and interesting way of thinking about things, I can't say. So it's almost useless for me to say or for you to listen to me and when I say I don't, I'm skeptical about it.
Just a moment. Don't go anywhere. Hey, I see you inching away. Don't be like the economy. Instead, read The Economist. I thought all The Economist was something that CEOs read to stay up to date on world trends. And that's true, but that's not only true. What I found more than useful for myself, personally, is their coverage of math, physics, philosophy, and AI, especially how something is perceived by other countries and how it may impact markets. For instance, The Economist had an interview with some of the people behind DeepSeek the week DeepSeek was launched. No one else had that. Another example is The Economist has this fantastic article on the recent dark energy data, which surpasses even Scientific American's coverage, in my opinion. They also have the chart of everything. It's like the chart version of this channel. It's something which is a pleasure to scroll through and learn from. Links to all of these will be in the description, of course. Now, The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means that you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments. I am personally interested in the more scientific ones, like this one on extending life via mitochondrial transplants, which creates actually a new field of medicine, something that would make Michael Levin proud. The Economist also covers culture, finance and economics, business, international affairs, Britain, Europe, the Middle East, Africa, China, Asia, the Americas, and of course, the USA. Whether it's the latest in scientific innovation or the shifting landscape of global politics, The Economist provides comprehensive coverage, and it goes far beyond just headlines. Look, if you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a new understanding, a deeper one, of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. I subscribe to them, and it's an investment into your intellectual growth. It's one that you won't regret. As a listener of this podcast, you'll get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/toe, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in, and now let's get back to the exploration of the mysteries of our universe. Again, that's economist.com/toe.